So my name is Mike Stenta. I'm the lead developer of farmOS. I'm also starting a farmOS hosting service called Farmier, which is like a software as a service kind of thing. If you're interested in hearing more, there's a newsletter and cards over there. So I also work with the Cornell Soil Health Lab and the APOS Institute, doing web development for them. And I'm a technical advisor at FarmHack, which is a nonprofit organization that helps farmers share their inventions and other hacks with each other. I was going to have a co-presenter with me today. He couldn't make it. I'm not much of a speaker, so I'll be reading off of this. But, so I got started in farming after college. I apprenticed on Dharma Ridge Farm in Washington State. And then I worked on Snake Root Farm in Pittsfield, Maine. And then my friend and I started a small veggie CSA in Sterling, Connecticut. Right now, I'm starting a small market garden at my home in Mansfield, Connecticut. I'm building farmOS at the same time, sort of to help me organize and remember what I'm doing throughout the process. So what is farmOS? The main goal is to have a database of everything that's happened on your farm. So you need to be able to record events and find that information in the future. That's the basis, but from that, you know, you can build a lot of cool stuff on top of. So the other goals are, you know, I need to be able to have this on my phone, my computer, my tablet. Multiple people need to be able to use it at the same time. It needs to be able to integrate information from other sources, like weather data from NOFA or other agencies, soil data from soil tests, as well as soil type information from the NRCS Soil Survey, and DIY sensors that can be used to automatically record things like temperature, humidity, soil moisture content, animal weights, those kind of things. So basically the goal is informed decision making. I'll get into more detail on a lot of that in the slides. So why farmOS? You know, there's a lot of software available and there's more kind of popping up every day. Why go to the trouble of building something again? Why reinvent the wheel? The biggest difference right now is that farmOS is free. So when I say that, I don't exactly mean free as in it doesn't cost anything. It is free in that regard too, but it's specific to the free software movement, which is more akin to the concept of free speech. So that means you are free to be able to do whatever you want with it. You can download the code, you can put it on your computer, you can change it, you can modify it, you can do whatever you want. You're free to do that. And you can contribute those changes back to the project so that we can kind of all work on it together. So it's community-built software. There's no single company or person that owns it. I started it, but I can't stop anyone from using it, and that's by design. If I were to get hit by a bus, someone else could pick it up and go keep it going. So enough about that stuff. I'll talk more about open source. So we'll start the slideshow. Okay, so it's about record keeping. So I really like this photo. This my friend Sarah took this. It's her father-in-law, that's his finger, was describing to her the layout of the pepper varieties that they have in their hoop house. It's on a flap of cardboard on an empty cardboard box in the greenhouse. The other three flaps show the hoop house tomatoes, onions in the field, and the lettuces. So, you know, we all do stuff like this, and it's great. Like, this is far better than not having any records at all, first of all. You know, anyone growing at scale knows that it's impossible to manage without at least something like this, to know, to remember, what is this in this area? So this is their farmOS. So they're also using it for a bunch of different things, in addition to the cardboard. So this is kind of it sort of serves a lot of purposes for them, but one of them is a backup for the, in case the cardboard rots away, which it will. So the main point, though, is that, you know, it doesn't matter what you use to keep records. It just matters that you keep records. So oftentimes that's sort of the first hurdle to get over. You know, this isn't gonna solve that problem. That's a habit that you need to get into first and foremost. But hopefully, you know, these kind of software like this will sort of inspire you to become better at keeping those records and hopefully make it easier to do too. But that's always a challenge also. So, you know, one of the goals of farmOS is to give you a place to store and organize all of that information. So you've got all these different things, all these different places. Why, again? I talked a little bit about it before, but I'll go into some more. So this is a quote I think that's good. Every good work of software starts by scratching a developer's personal itch. This is by Eric S. Raymond, who wrote The Cathedral and the Bazaar, which is a really good essay on open source software in general. I'll touch on that again in a minute. But yeah, basically I started farmOS as a hobby project for myself because I'm a software developer and I like making things myself, and I wanted to make something that I could use to record all this stuff, but also do it in a way that other people could use it too, basically. So yeah, I cobbled together a bunch of other freely available components, all open source, like open layers for mapping, Drupal for the basic framework, jQuery, you know, a bunch of different programming libraries. I won't go too into details on that, but. And the main goal at the time when I first started was crop management. So remembering, these are my plantings, I've done seedings on these dates, transplantings, here's the inputs, harvests, et cetera. And then just general record keeping. So like I could make a note that like, oh, I observed this beetle on my cabbages or something like that. So now the big picture goals of the project, manage everything. So not just plantings, animals, equipment, soil, bees, maple, mushrooms, whatever. It's a modular platform, so these things can be added on, and you can even make your own to kind of extend it. Other ones that people have suggested are compost management. There's a couple of other suggestions out there too. But the basic idea is you kind of define these assets, I'll call them, and then logs that go along with those assets. So you kind of have this flexible framework to start thinking about these things. Organize information, so all in one place. So you're not using one software for your livestock and one software for your crops and one for, you know, your sensors and stuff. And the ability to relate records to one another, that comes from being all in one place, so that makes it easier. The ability to approach from multiple angles. So when you're looking for information in the past, you need to be able to find it in the way that you would find it in your own brain. So, you know, if I'm thinking about, if I want to remember how much fertilizer I put on the tomatoes or something, my brain would go, okay, the tomatoes were in this greenhouse, so I'll go to the greenhouse, then I'll find the tomatoes, then the log for the input will be there. And there, you know, however you can think of it too, you can also go to the whole list of inputs or the list of tomatoes and, you know, kind of follow down the path that way. So save your brain space. You know, it provides a place to put these things so that you don't have to remember it all. You know, you can, you probably still will, but just a little bit to offload, you know. Farm mapping is also a big piece of it too, because obviously farming is a very map-oriented endeavor. So the ability to draw fields, greenhouses, buildings on the map, import shape files that were created by your GPS or Google Earth or your tractor even. Custom aerial imagery. I don't have a demo of that, but we do have that capability too. So that's cool. Like if you have a drone or a weather balloon or something, you just put a camera on it. I was working with a guy who has kites that he takes aerial photography with, and then you can stitch that together and put it into your map in farmOS. So you can get, because Google, you know, the base layers here are Google Maps, and they're good, but you know, they're not always up to date and they're not always very high detail. So depending on where you are, it may be good, maybe not. Mapping of activities, same thing. Decision support, so make it easy to remember the past, provide tools to plan for the future, adapt to the unexpected, and provide recommendations. Provide recommendations is not a feature yet, but that's where we're headed. That's the idea. So by having all the information in one place, you can start, you know, you're going through this process in your own minds right now. You're taking all this information and kind of figuring out what to do with it. So if some of those things can be passed down from one person to another, you know, we can maybe code them up into a module or something too, so that they can be used to provide recommendations through farmOS. And data ownership. So data is valuable. A lot of software you upload your data to. Most provide a way to get it back, which is really good. But ultimately, usually you're signing over the rights to that data too, so that it can be aggregated and used by the companies that you're giving it to. So with farmOS, you're in control. You know, you have this software on your computer that you're putting the data into. You don't have to share it with anyone. But there are a lot of reasons why you might want to share that data in different ways. You know, maybe not all of it, parts of it. And that kind of gets to the next point. So farmOS is a platform to build upon. So it can be used by farmers for record keeping. It can also provide a way for researchers to work with farmers by having a place to sort of start gathering some of that management data. I'm working with the Cornell Soil Health Lab right now, and one of the things that we've talked about doing is making a module so that when you send your soil sample to Cornell, you can receive your information back directly in farmOS, so it's stored alongside all the other stuff. And then service providers, so consultants or ag service providers that you want to work with, you can maybe share some access to your farmOS with so that they can see what you're doing, provide recommendations, that kind of thing. And one big goal is to create a community. So it's free and open source, like I said. It's built on Drupal, which already has translation capabilities built in. So I've already gotten contacted by a number of different people in different countries who are interested in contributing translations. We're starting to organize some of that. Unit conversion, so metric versus imperial, that kind of thing. And anyone can contribute. So it's all happening over the internet, and we have monthly calls to talk about stuff. Anyone's allowed to come. So just what does it mean to be free and open source? I'll try not to spend too much time on this because I don't know if any of you have. I've done two talks in the past about open source in general, so I don't know if you've seen those, but it helps to understand some of the things that have been happening in the world of software development to kind of see what the context is of this. So open source. The definition of open source, this was provided by the Open Source Initiative, which was founded in 1998. So this is about code. Like, if you create a project written in code and you want to call it open source, it needs to abide by these 10 rules, essentially. So I'll just read the first couple, because but free redistribution, so you need to be able to take the code and redistribute it yourself. You have to be able to view the source code, so you have to be able to see all the code that's running it. And you have to be able to create works based off of it without any restrictions. You can kind of read more about these on opensource.org. I won't go into a ton of detail. So then alongside the open source movement, there's also this free software movement. And this one goes back even farther. So in 1985, Richard Stallman founded the Free Software Foundation, and it provides the following definition of free software. So a lot of overlap with open source. Freedom to run the program as you wish for any purpose, freedom zero. And the numbering is a reference to programming, which starts at 0, 1, 2, 3. Anyways, the freedom to study how the program works and change it so it does your computing as you wish. Access to the source code is a precondition for this. the freedom to redistribute copies so you can help your neighbor, and the freedom to distribute copies of your modified versions to others. By doing this, you can give the whole community a chance to benefit from your changes. Access to the source code is a precondition for this. So this is Richard Stallman. He's the guy who founded the Free Software Foundation. The two movements kind of inform and support one another, but they are sort of two different movements. This is how he kind of sums it up. Open source is a development methodology, and free software is a social movement. FarmOS is both. So I talked about, I mentioned the cathedral and the bazaar earlier. This was an essay written by Eric S. Raymond, basically about his experience working on various open source projects and what the lessons kind of that he learned from that. It talks about the struggle between the top-down and bottom-up development. The cathedral represents top-down development, whereas the bazaar represents bottom-up. So he, in his essay, he outlines 19 different lessons learned, one of which, treating your users as co-developers is your least hassle route to rapid code improvement and effective debugging. So essentially, you know, working from the bottom up, you've got a lot of eyes on the project. Anyone can look at the source code. Anyone can contribute ideas, fix bugs, those kind of things. I think another way to phrase this that's been used is the more eyes you have, the shallower the bugs are, because someone will come up with a solution to something. It's widely cited, this essay, by a lot of open source advocates. Jimmy Wales, the guy who made Wikipedia, credited it as one of his inspirations. So a couple of examples of open source software you may recognize. Linux, it's an open source operating system that Android is based off of it, so is Ubuntu, if you've ever heard of those. iPhones and Apple computers are based off of another open source operating system called FreeBSD, which shares some historical roots. So these are the classic proprietary option is Windows, which most are familiar with. So that's not open source. You can't look at the source code. Mozilla Firefox, that's a web browser, very popular. Google Chrome, if you use that too, is largely open source too. It's based on an open source project called Chromium. Apache, maybe you haven't heard of. This is the most popular web server software on the internet. So a large percentage of the websites you visit are actually served by this software. So it powers a lot of the web. Drupal, which is a web application framework that FarmOS is built upon. And OpenLayers, this is the open source mapping library that FarmOS uses. So another point to make is that open source development is cumulative. It's you're building on the things that came before, standing on the shoulders of giants. When a problem is solved, everyone gets the solution. When improvements are made, everyone benefits. So the ideas of the open source software movement, you know, kind of spread out into the real world, and eventually the idea of open source hardware became a thing. So a number of different groups have kind of taken this on and started developing real world applications, real world things that are also considered open source, where they share the plans for them. And, this is a great example. I don't know if you've heard of FarmHack, but they are a great community. I actually included the video here. It's only like 3 minutes, so I'll just play it because I think it's really cool and it sums it up.
FarmHack is a farmer-driven community to develop, document, and build tools for resilient agriculture. For the last 50 years, mainstream agricultural technology has progressed along a trajectory of bigger is better, with top-down chemical, capital, and energy-intensive machines. The kind of equipment we need is affordable, adaptable, and easy to fix. Because of the lack of such equipment in the marketplace, many of us restore and retrofit old equipment or create new tools built from scratch. We want the right tools for the job, and the job is sustainable agriculture. The FarmHack community was founded in 2010 by a group of farmers and organizers to address this need. Inspired by many individual efforts for inventive design and adaptation, we wanted to create a space for collaboration, allowing us to share skills, ideas, and designs. We wanted to team up with non-farmers who have relevant skill sets and build new relationships and manufacturing capacity in our local economies. We bring our community together both in person and online. Attending our farmers, engineers, fabricators, and others who come together in support of resilient and successful farming systems. As an operating system, the FarmHack community is built on open source principles. The platform is built on Drupal, and the community and all products of it are available to and editable by all. It is horizontal exchange of information, principles, and mechanical ideas. On the website, you can contribute or learn from a forum or the tool wikis. The site works because users document the tools they've made or modified. This creates a directory of innovations and ideas to build from. Each tool is documented in the FarmHack method using links, videos, components, and schematics for works in progress or functioning prototypes. You can even offer polished products as kits for sale. Because FarmHack is an open source community, whose success is driven by the needs of its users, our growing strength comes from users like you. We hope you will join the FarmHack community. Join in the spirit of open source, of mutual aid, appropriate technology, and mechanical innovation to join us in the regional manufacturing and fabrication of good tools for good farms. These are the values and tools that fit the ethics and systems of our sustainable farms and the new economy we're building together. Come hack with us at farmhack.org.
So that's a great website. You should check it out if you haven't already. They have weekly organizer calls too that anyone's can join. So another project, just to show another example, maybe you've heard of this one recently too, FarmBot. This is a CNC farming machine. So it sort of started as a project, and now it's turned into like a full product that you can actually buy the kit for. They just had like a pre-order campaign that was pretty successful. So the idea is I think more geared towards like small background or backyard farm beds, kind of like this. But I mean, just the fact that this is being done by people is pretty cool, and that all the plans are available. Okay, so next. Okay, so farmOS. We talked a bunch about the ideas behind open source. Let's look at some farmOS stuff. So farmOS is a web-based application for agricultural management, planning, and record keeping. So when I say it's web-based, what that means is it's essentially a website. You go to it from any device that has an internet browser, so you can use your laptop, you can use your computer, you can use your phone, tablet, and you just go to it by typing in the web address of your FarmOS. Currently, the version is 1.0-beta 12. So that means that it's the 12th beta release, working towards an official 1.0. And it's kind of arbitrary, the beta designation. I think the next one might be 1.0. I don't know. It doesn't really matter. It's pretty stable. People are using it. That's just kind of convention and saves me from committing to the 1.0.
So you said earlier that in terms of the data, that it's if I use it, it's my data.
Yep.
But if it's web-based, where's the data go?
Yeah, so there's two options. You can either install it on your own computer and run it as a web server locally, or you can use a hosted thing. So that's kind of what I'm setting up with Farmier. Is for people who don't want to set it up, don't want to manage the hosting side of things, you can. You can use something like Farmier. So that's the idea there.
So if I want to like lock my data down, I would have to run my own server and then have my own. My phone is the client out in the field?
That would be the most secure way to do it, yep.
Thank you.
So the 1.x, so right now I'm working towards 1.0. 1.x, these are sort of the goals for that. It's basically laying the groundwork, so get, you know, the basic things in place, mapping of areas, tracking of assets and their history, and some basic sensor integration. Those are the kind of main things that I've been working on in this 1.x branch. I'm very excited, though, about 2.x, already thinking ahead, to really start refining things, get more into some of the inventory management, bookkeeping, reporting and analysis, life cycles of all your assets and that kind of stuff. So, you know, I'm probably gonna get started on that pretty soon. But that's sort of where things are right now. So let's start looking at some stuff. This is the farm dashboard. So basically you've got a map on your left that you have all your areas that you can map them all out on. So you can click on the areas. It'll show you kind of a summary of estimated area, so like 5.5 acres, and the number of plantings you have there. This over here on the right would be sort of your to-do list. So if you've got logs that are in the future, they would show up there, and they're not done yet, so they would show up there. And you can see what you need to do based on the date, and you can check things off and say, "Yep, did that." So that they end up in the archive essentially. The top is the basic, you know, all the main links and stuff. So the main things to see are like areas, assets, logs, and people. So areas are your areas. Assets are the things. I'll go into more detail on all these, but. So examples of assets would be your plantings, your animals, your equipment, things, essentially. Logs are the events that are related to those things and to areas, essentially. So you can make a log of an input that is that it references a planting, so that's an input to that planting, but it can also reference an area because that planting might be out in a field, so that field is also getting that input, essentially. So that's where the cross-referencing kind of comes into play. All these different entities you can, all these different records you can add can be cross-referenced with one another. So it is data input. You know, you do have to like type this stuff in right now. Working on ways of making that easier and somewhat automated too, I'll talk about in a little bit. So then these three links here are how you can start by adding an area, adding an asset, and adding a log. So if you start out with farmOS, you're just going to see a blank map, blank plan, and you'll probably start by mapping out your farm by going to add an area and map things out. So I'll talk about that now. So mapping of areas, there's different area types. You can have fields, buildings, paddocks. There's a bunch of different ones. It's easy to add new ones to a little bit of code, but yeah. You can draw with points, lines, and polygons. On the map, they're color-coded by type. If I jump back, you can see like the yellow ones are fields, these are beds and paddocks. That's a building, the red one. There's some others. So this is, oh, I might have missed the point. Oh yeah, and it gives you an estimated acres or hectares. So this is what it looks like to add an area. You would go and type in the name. You can give it a description if you want. Choose a type, so a field. And then when you're editing, the map gives you these buttons down at the bottom to draw out the field just by clicking. And then you double click to finish it, and it gives you the polygon coordinates, and then you save it. And there it is on your map. So, you know, it's tedious if you've got a lot of fields. That's why, I'll get to that, hold on. Area hierarchy, so you can arrange your, once you've got your areas in there, you can like put them into a hierarchy. So you've got your fields within fields, beds within those fields, buildings, you've got your property, that kind of thing. Just kind of gives you a way of organizing things.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
How do you get the original map?
Yeah, so right now there's a button that allows you to zoom to where you currently are, so it'll use your IP address and do geolocation. That's probably the easiest way to do it. Yeah. I've also on another project worked with a thing that can geocode from an address. So I'm thinking about adding that just as an easy way to get in. But once you get your first area in, then the map automatically zooms to that. So then you can work off of that, basically.
Yeah, you might have multiple properties.
That too.
Different addresses.
Yeah, that too. Yep. And like that's a good example. This farm has a bunch of leased fields too, so sort of spread out. But I'll show you how he actually went about importing. So if by chance you have your areas already drawn in another program like Google Earth, you can export those as KML files and then import them into farmOS. So here's an example of that, creating a new area. The basic process is you start by creating an area, you go down and you upload your KML file to the files field. So areas can have files attached and photos attached and other things. So you do that, then you come up and click find using files field, and it just pulls it in from the KML file. So that's helpful, and you know, as we're refining farmOS, it may still be easier to map your farm in Google Earth or something. So that's an option, and then you can pull it into farmOS that way. So Google Earth is probably better at mapping at this point because it's made by Google, but we'll get there. This is a really cool example that just came up this week, actually. I was chatting with a guy in Norway who was using farmOS, and he imported this from his tractor. So this is he went around to do a spraying, I think, of some kind, and this is the GPS path that his tractor created, and it was able to be exported in a KML file. He imported it into farmOS, not as an area, because it's not really an area, but as an input. So inputs themselves can have map geometries too, as well as, so can activities and observations. Pretty much all the log types, which I'll show you, can have geometries on them also, which is cool, I think. So this was a little add-on tool. I think this is a good example of, like, once we lay the groundwork, things can be built upon it, sort of. I made this recently. So a lot of organic produce farms, you know, divide their fields into parallel beds, but drawing all those is hard. So here's a tool that will draw them for you. It's an area generator, so you go and you select the larger area. You say, I want to create beds. You type how many, 40, and you give it an orientation, which is just an angle. You can preview it, so it'll show you what the lines will look like. And then generate, and go back to your areas. Then you can zoom in, and you've got bed 14, bed 19. So then you can start adding records quickly to those beds, kind of. So what I'm going to be working on pretty soon is because beds change, you know, areas change too. So the ability to archive the areas so that next year, if you are doing something totally different, you can still keep your old archived records but have a new ones.
That's very important.
Yeah. Yep. So we've already got a plan for that, pretty much. The plan is actually to convert areas into a type of asset, which. It's sort of a technical, it gets into some of the technical elements of farmOS, but there's a lot of overlap. You know, areas are essentially assets if you think about it in one way or another. So it's just going to be a process of converting over to that sort of method. But assets themselves can already be archived, so you can already kind of make those go into the archives. So assets. Assets represent things. So FarmOS, by default, when you install it, it comes with three: plantings, animals, and equipment. You can turn them off too. You don't have to, if you don't raise livestock or, you know, don't want to manage your equipment, you can just do plantings. They're all modules, so that's sort of the nice architectural thing about Drupal, which this is based upon, is it's just a combination of different modules that add features to the overall platform. So FarmOS is just Drupal plus farm-specific features that I've built, modules, essentially. One of them is the farm crop module, which creates the plantings asset. Another one is the farm livestock module, which creates the animals one. and the equipment one is another one. Those are provided by default in farmOS, but new modules can be written to add other things. So I started keeping some bees this year, so I wrote a beekeeping module that has a colony asset type, and I'm going to be adding a inspection log type so that I can kind of record the inspections. I've also created a maple one for managing maple harvest, and mushrooms for like mushroom logs or other substrates.
Can you copy an asset and then kind of like paste it into another add-on?
You could essentially copy the code into a new add-on and then modify it to be what you want.
Well, what I'm thinking is like your where you had your layout of the rows.
Yep.
There, and if you wanted to save that as an archive, if you could copy it and then just paste it into like 2016.
Oh yeah.
As a.
That's an interesting idea. Yeah, I mean that might be possible. I'd have to think that through, but yeah.
Okay.
I'll show you one thing that might be related to that in a second. That has to do with movements and that kind of. So where am I? Assets. So before I go into more details on the assets. Oh well, never mind. So this is what a list of, this is like what the full list of assets looks like, which you usually don't use this list, but it's just a demo. But up there, you'll see like a drop down with different asset types. So there's plantings, animals, equipment. Those are the three that come with it, but you saw some others there too. So if I click on plantings, it shows a map of where my specific plantings are. Here's all the plantings. You can click to see, you know, which ones are in each bed, kind of. And then you can click through to a specific one. So this is my Dakota black popcorn planting. And for this planting, it has observations, seedings, movements. Those are different types of logs that are associated with this planting, essentially. So the same thing goes for, this is an observation log. So the same thing goes for, it's a bit of a mess. the same thing goes for all asset types. So your equipment has logs, your animals have logs, and there are general logs like activity. Well, here, I'm getting ahead of myself. So logs represent events. There are general ones that apply to all asset types, like activities, observations, movements. Inputs and harvest can also pretty much apply to anything. But then you can also have ones that are specific to certain asset types. So for example, equipment. Is that the next slide? Well, equipment has a maintenance log, for example, so you can record maintenance. Animals have a medical log for medical records. Plantings have seedings and transplantings, which are only specific to that.
For the observations section, how easy is it when you're out in the field and you want to make like a photo of to get into the program,
yeah,
and put in the photo under the categories. I mean, does it take minutes to do, or is it just like something that comes quickly now?
I would say it takes under a minute to do, but I've also been using it a lot. So, you know, I'm working on trying to make things as convenient and easy as possible. It still is loading up a website, uploading the image and stuff. But most phones, if you've got a camera on your phone and you go to a website and you click the choose file thing, it gives you the option to open up your camera, so you can just use it directly through your phone in that way. One thing that I'm excited to work on soon is a Chrome app, which is like a gives you the ability to have sort of some offline components too, because that's the other thing, you do need to have an internet connection in order to upload stuff. But one thing that I'm excited to do is make some simplified native apps that can work offline just for gathering that information, so you could very quickly get an observation in with some simple notes, like you said. And then when it's online again, it'll sync that into your farmOS. So we don't have that right now, but that's, I think, the next step for it.
That might be important because I don't have very good internet.
Yeah, it's a common problem. Although that is, in terms of internet access, I've talked with a lot of people about this. I sort of see that it is a problem. I see it as a separate problem from what I'm trying to solve here. And it's being solved by a lot of other technologies now too. Dorn, who is gonna be with me today, he, on his farm, he's got a 300 acre farm. He's using this technology called Ubiquity, I think, that allows you to create a Wi-Fi bridge across properties, so you can create Wi-Fi bubbles. He actually has a an access point on his golf cart, so he can drive around and have Wi-Fi on wherever his golf cart is, essentially. So there's some options. It's takes
and,
some.
And that, is that open source also?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure about that. You'd have to ask him. You can probably find that information online, though. So this is the like main list of logs, just like the main list of assets. Again, you'll probably never really use this list, maybe, but you can also go up to the logs and filter by specific types. So here's observations, all harvests. So with a harvest log, for example, you can take a photo if you want. You can say how many pounds of something you got. You can also have a geometry associated with it, so you can say, like, I harvested this part of the row, not the whole thing. If you really want to get it's, if you want to get that fine detail, it's, you know, farmOS doesn't really make any assumptions about how much records you want to keep. It just gives you a place to keep them and hopefully makes it easy. So here's some movements. Movements I'll talk about in a second because those are important. Yep. Sure.
Maintenance logs.
Yep.
Could you do something where you could do like a planned maintenance schedule for your equipment?
Yeah, you definitely. So you can make logs. That's another important point I forgot to mention. Logs aren't just things that happened in the past. You can create logs with a future date. And logs have a concept of done or not done. So what you would do is just create a future maintenance log. With that is not done. And then it'll show up on your to-do list so that when that date comes, you can do it and then mark it as done. Or you can postpone it if you need more time or something.
And we could create, like, if we wanted to have a log for irrigation, we could have a log for irrigation or just under set category.
Well, so that's a good question. So what are you trying to record? Like that you irrigated?
Just like irrigation dates. And
yeah. So for that, I would probably use an input log, I think. But it's sort of up to you. You can also use an activity log type. There could be an argument for creating an irrigation log type specifically, too. We don't have that now, but usually when I'm recording waterings, I use an input log myself. And input logs give you the ability to list like a material, quantity, that kind of stuff. Here's the equipment example. So with equipment, just like with other assets, you can attach documents. So you can have your owner's manual, parts list. I find this really helpful. Like if I'm working on my rototiller or something, I can just open up the parts list and see like, okay, this is the piece I need to get on my phone, you know, because I've got it all in there. It's just a PDF. You can keep track of maintenance and you can remember where you left it. Which is helpful. Dorn joked that he wants to get a tracker for his dad because on the 300 acre farm he doesn't have a cell phone, so he can never find his dad. So here's the equipment example. That's my rototiller. So you can see you can have your record, you can put photos in. This shows where it currently is in the barn. Owner's manual and parts list. Activities, so you can actually record all the activities you've done if you want. Maintenance, so I can see that I changed the oil back then, and then I'm like, oh wait, I should really change the oil. So I'll do that on September 1st. So this is an example of creating one in the future.
Can we add things like what it costs, like keep track of what it's costing if you maintain?
So right now there's just kind of a general notes field, so you can definitely add that information. The goals of the 2.x is kind of where I'm putting thought into having a lot more bookkeeping, inventory management, costs, purchases, that kind of stuff. So right now it's still a little simple.
Cross-reference to like tax codes and stuff.
Yeah, there's a lot to get into, so all help is welcome. You had a question?
Can you
Yeah, you can upload them as files. Yep. So, these are just a file upload field. So yeah, any files can be uploaded. Yep. You had a question?
Can you assign tasks to your laborer, to your worker?
That's a great question. Not right now, but that's very easy to add. It's like one of the obvious ones that I just haven't gotten around to doing yet. So that'll probably be in the 1.x. So probably pretty soon. But yeah, I'll show you in a minute. You can add as many people as you want, so everyone can have their own user login. So really, it's a pretty easy next step to start assigning tasks. Another thing is like time tracking, so having a little like punch in, punch out kind of thing, I think would be really helpful.
Just a note on the assignment thing. Once you put in the ability to assign, you don't want everybody able to assign, because if somebody doesn't want to do the grunt work, they'll
bump it to someone else. Yeah. Well, luckily, and I'll show this in a second, there's roles and permissions in farmOS.
That's what I'm talking about, roles.
Yeah. So we already have, and I'll show this in a second, three roles. Well, I'll get into that. But yeah, the basic idea is you could have a role that is allowed to assign tasks and a role that can't reassign.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
You have your managers and you have your farm workers, basically. So movements and location. This is, I think, really important. Takes a little bit of thought to wrap your mind around, but essentially, location of all assets in farmOS is determined by movement logs. So in order to say that something is in a certain place, you have to create a movement log that says it is in this place. You can move assets individually by going to the asset and saying add a movement, and that'll assign its location. Or you can do it in bulk by selecting all and creating one movement log that references all those assets. So that's handy for grazing, for example. If you're moving your whole herd, one of your herds, to from one paddock to another, which I think is demoed here, you want to be able to select them in bulk. And you don't want to have an individual movement log for everyone, because that's just kind of so in this one, I want to move from the middle bay to the east bay. So I clicked on middle bay, clicked five animals, select all, click move. Going a little fast, sorry. This is a movement log being created. I'm saying to the east bay from the middle bay. That was auto-filled. And it's done. So save log. Now all of them have moved to the east bay. If I click on one of them, it'll now say location is the East Bay, and this goes to what you were asking. When you create a movement log, it automatically copies the geometry from the area that you move to. So it does kind of create an archive of the area's shapes over time. So if you did go and delete that area, this movement would still have that shape assigned to it. One of the reasons for that, and I think I, I'll just finish here. So again, selecting all, click that. This starts creating a movement log. So the to field is the most important. From is optional. You don't have to fill that in, but the to field is what says they are here. This is where they are moving to on this specific date at this specific time. And it can be in the future too, so you can plan your movements in advance. But like if I go back to I'll have to wait a second, but remember when it showed the plantings and the beds, and you could click on them and it would show you the shapes? Those are generated from movement logs, not from areas. So all those plantings have been moved to those beds, so now they show up here. These are movement logs all being aggregated together to show you what's here right now based on movements. So yeah, it's...
So what are some examples of how I can use that information, like say for sheep?
Yeah.
If I have a certain group of sheep that I've always kept together as I move them from field to field.
Yeah, yep.
They come up having worms, right?
Uh-huh.
And I want to look back at the fields that they were in so I don't put other sheep in them.
Yeah.
How would I do that?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So I think this screen share will show that probably at the end. But so say you know that one of these cows has worms, you click on one of them. This shows you the cow's record. Mm-hmm. Now, all the way down at the bottom of this, I don't know if it scrolls down, but yes, movements. So that shows all the movements that that cow has made. So you can see these are the places that they've been, essentially.
And you'd be able to, like, in theory, also see that on an area record too, right? Like, if you went to, like,
yeah,
Middle Bay and I was like, oh, the cows are there.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think I have that. Well, see, yeah, it already shows when you click on it, it says there's five there. But if you click through to Middle Bay, it'll show you
that there were five there.
Yeah. Yeah, so there's actually, that's a great question. There's two lists that are shown on the area on Middle Bay's record. One is the animals that are currently there, and then down at the bottom, there's one that we added for specifically for like organic record keeping, a history of all assets that have ever been in this area. So that aggregates all the logs together, all the movement logs for that area.
Is there a report?
Not with graphs. Right now, what you could do is go up to logs and go to movements, and that would show you all the movements that have taken place on your farm, and there's a filter, so you can filter down to certain things. So that's kind of what you have right now. But yeah, I think in the 2.x version is going to be more for the analysis of things. Yeah, right. And that's going to be the powerful part. Yep. So we're getting there. Slowly but surely. So in order to determine the location of an asset, kind of reiterating here, it looks at all the movement logs for that asset and gets the most recent done one. And then that's where the animal is, essentially. So if it's not done, then they're not there. Movement logs themselves store a copy of the area's geometry by default, which I mentioned before. So if your areas change shape over time, the movements will maintain their own history. So you do have kind of a history. It's not really linked back to the area. Well, it sort of is, but we could improve upon that, I think, a little bit.
Do you overlap, like, past shapes with future shapes?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I think this example is kind of helps understand why each movement can have its own geometry too, and why we store the geometry for each one. Aside from the history of the area, it also means that you can set an even more specific geometry within movement logs, independent of the geometry of the area it's moving in. So say, here's an example, I have some chickens that I keep in a mobile coop with a mobile fence. So when I first started building farmOS, I was creating areas for each time I moved the fence, and then I just had this whole like mass of areas on my map. That wasn't really helpful because they kept changing, you know. And then I was like, well, maybe I'll just try to move them back to the exact same spot, and then I don't have to create another area. But it's messy. So instead of doing that, now you can say I moved the chickens to the upper garden. That's the larger area, and then you can go into the movement log of that movement and draw the fence line. So it's within the larger area. So
within the movements module, you can redraw the
yep.
area?
Yeah, so here, I'll show you. This is creating a movement log right here. I typed in East Bay. If I don't do anything else, it'll copy the geometry from there. But here's the map. So you can draw right on the movement. Maybe I'll live demo that afterwards to make it make more sense. But the movements will automatically copy the geometry of the area that they reference unless you give it a more specific geometry. So that gives you some flexibility for that.
So that could be true too for like, I left my tractor over here
yeah.
versus here,
yep.
or like, okay.
You could say, I left my tractor in the north field and put a point exactly in the north field where it is, which is helpful in some cases. So yeah, the example I was giving, the chickens in the mobile coop, move them every 2 weeks to a new patch of grass, all within the same field. Yeah, so I can look back on exactly where my chickens have been, too, without cluttering up my list of areas with all the arbitrary temporary fence lines. This is cool. Soil tests. So if you get soil tests, what do you do with them? Do they just like end up in a file somewhere? Do you lose them? Probably. You can put them in farmOS, so you can keep keep them there. So soil tests are a type of log. So if, so if you create a soil test, you can just create a new log saying, I took this soil test now. You can reference the lab that you sent it to. It integrates with the NRCS soil survey. This is some of the work that I did with the Cornell Soil Health Lab. I'll show you in a second. And you can attach the PDF reports. So here's an example going up to logs, soil tests. Here's all the soil tests. You can click on one. And they have, you know, specific areas, names.
So you
can say exactly where you took the samples from using points.
In that listing of soil tests,
yep.
You can click on the column header and it'll sort by that column so that if I want to see all the ones for a particular one,
yep.
And look at those over time.
Yep. Okay. And there's like a PDF upload. And then so adding a soil test, this is the fun part. So you give it a name, you know, whatever you want, fall 2016. I think it'll auto name if you don't do it. So it's in the upper garden. And then you can turn on the NRCS soil survey layer. That'll put your, pull in the layer from the NRCS soil survey server, which has all the different soil types. And then you click your points to say, you know, these are where I took my samples from. Then come down here and say, look up soil names, and it'll automatically fill in the soil names and types from those points, essentially. So you can kind of keep track of that. Yeah, so that's the soil test.
Have you thought, you're not capturing the actual soil test data?
No. This is just sort of keeping, this is creating a log that you did do a soil test. Then you send your sample out to the lab, you get your report back, and you attach that report to this record. So it's just a place to organize
it. There's no way you can get, the labs don't, there's no database of test results that you could.
No, but I mentioned that earlier, that's one of the things I'm hoping to work with Cornell on is the ability to, like, once they're done analyzing your sample, send it right to farmOS.
Yeah, that would be great if you see contributing reports in the different fields and what those.
Yeah, and you get a little notification that's like your results are ready.
Yeah, but not everybody's going to use Cornell.
Right, right.
So, I mean,
right.
Like, I have problems that when something's in a PDF,
yep.
I can't really get the data out of it to cross reference against even another PDF file.
Yep. So, the two points there, the one Cornell specific thing, each lab could potentially provide its own farmOS module. So Cornell could have its own Cornell farmOS module that allows for communication with Cornell server. Other labs can do their own things. So that's how maybe to approach that one, you know, that's one possible. And then regarding data points specifically, so right now it's pretty simple. You just upload a PDF. You can also type in stuff in the notes field if you want. But the next step, which is not too hard, is to just add specific fields for the pH, the magnesium, each data point, so that can start being tracked too. Now, you know, the big thing there is right now, that's a lot of data entry, but it's easy to add those fields. I could add those and roll it out in the next release.
Right, being able to get this stuff in there
automatically. Yeah, right, so that's where, you know, you gotta work with the soil labs or just manually copy it over from your soil test if you want to do that.
So is there an open source version of PDF?
I don't really know too much about that. I'm not sure. But yeah, I think the challenge would mainly be extracting from a PDF that could be in any different format. I mean, there could be, or just like, you know, one lab PDF might look this way, another one might look that way. So common extraction would be difficult, I think. But maybe possible.
Yeah. It's certainly possible.
Yeah.
But I think the main thing, you can extract from PDFs, but if you always use the same lab, then somebody could, you know.
Right.
Yeah, yep, if they have the same template. Yep. How am I on time? When does this end, 11:30? Okay. I wanna leave some time for questions and stuff. Sensors, so this is a fun one that I've been working on along with a bunch of people at FarmHack. So RJ Steinert at FarmHack has a project called the Open Pipe Kit, which he's working on to create, make it very easy for you to set up your own DIY sensors, essentially. And so I worked with him on making a module to pipe that data into farmOS, so you can start recording your temperature of your greenhouse, your humidity of your root cellar, those kind of things. And you have alerts. It's all still pretty basic, but we're getting the main features in. You can have alerts. Graphing and analysis is coming soon. But the main thing, it's also modular. So if you have a specific, if a company is making a specific proprietary sensor, they could potentially release a farmOS module for it that allows it to communicate with their sensor and pull that data in. So they can keep their proprietary sensor if they want and then have this component so that you can still use it in farmOS, essentially. So here's a quick demo of this. This is on Doran's farm. So he's got a humidity and a temperature sensor set up in the basement of one of his houses where he keeps his seed potatoes. So here's two sensors. This is the temperature one. So sensors are assets too, just like everything else. So it all works in the same way. You can have movements, you can have activities, observations, whatever, but they also have a sensor data stream. So you can see it was 21.13 degrees Celsius yesterday when I made this video. So again, it's kind of like, you know, I'm just kind of trying to lay a lot of the groundwork and provide a place to start pulling all this stuff in. What we do with it after that is the next step, you know? Another thing with the sensors. So also on Doran's farm earlier this summer, we had a farm hack session where along with this, we were playing around with actuators, so sensors take in data, actuators turn things on and off. So I've also been talking with a high tunnel installation company about setting up farmOS with sensors and actuators to open and close the greenhouse louvers. So if it gets too hot, it opens up the louvers, turns on the fan maybe. Still a little ways off, and there's a lot to figure out with that. But I mean, people are already doing that with sensors built in. But then having like your greenhouse with a button that you could say turn on the fan would be pretty cool, I think.
On your smartphone.
Yeah.
Yep. It alarms you. It's getting hot in there.
Right? Exactly. So that's that we already have. There's a basic alert system that can send an email if it goes above or below a threshold. So, okay, people and roles. This is what I mentioned before. So you can have multiple user logins. And right now there are three roles. But this is all built on Drupal. And one of the things that Drupal has is a very fine-tuned fine-grained permission system. So you define the roles and you define what permissions those roles have. So these are just the three that I made to go with farmOS, but new ones could be added if you need different stuff. Farm manager has full access. Farm worker has more limited access. They can't change configuration, but they can add logs and assets and that kind of thing. And then farm viewer is read-only, meaning they can come and look at your farm, but they can't change anything. So that's really helpful, I think, for like organic certification or working with a consultant or a soil lab that you want to give access to, but you don't want them to touch it, basically. So here's how you add people. You go up to the people section, and this shows you your people. Add a person. This is a little bit like small because my screen, when I recorded it, was kind of big. So you can always, I often, when I'm using it, I just zoom in on the web page and makes everything bigger. It's up to you how you, some people prefer detail. So that's all. So I just created a farm worker and that sent an email to that person with the login so they can get access. So coming up on the to-do list, crop planner. This is one that I'm really interested in doing. So, you know, right now you can add your plantings, but it's sort of a tedious process. You have to add your planting, saying like 2016 popcorn or whatever, and then you add separate logs for your seedings, for your transplantings, for your movements. And I'm going to change this soon. Right now, movements are different than seedings and transplanting, so, you know, They're related, so I'm working on getting that together. That will probably be part of the 1.x. But the crop planner, what the idea there is you have a tool that will allow you to auto-generate all your logs in advance. So you can say, I want to grow corn, It'll create the asset, it'll create your seeding log, it'll create your transplanting log, well, not for corn, but. So that's where the difficulty is though, is the first step is creating some basic crop databases. So meaning like, what do tomatoes need? When do they need to be transplanted? When do they need to be transplanted? And different methods, because everyone's going to do things differently too. So the ability to kind of create these recipes for different crops, and then that will just translate into a plan for you for the season, to make things easier. So similarly, a grazing planner would work in the same way, kind of looking into, you know, how long are your animals on a given plot of land based on the size of the land, the weather, the number of animals, to plan out your movements in advance. Task assignment and time tracking, that was brought up. And more data import and export. So, you know, there's the KML import. It's all a MySQL database, so technically it is possible to like just do an import and export through that, but there's not really much UI right now. So I'd like to make some ways of exporting spreadsheets and importing spreadsheets. The real thing to decide there, it's mainly just a decision factor of like, what do the rows and columns need to be that most people use, or what would be most useful? You know, I'll probably start by making something that's specific to farmOS, but you might need something that is, you know, ability to import from another program or something like that. So that's where it's just defining the requirements and figuring out what specifically needs to happen. There's a lot of like really obvious ones and easy ones, and most of those are on the list, but if you have more ideas, feel free to.
Propagation, sometimes you'll sow things like you do into styrofoam trays.
Okay,
yep. And then they'll be in the hardening off area for too long, but it'd be nice if you had an email notification for when they've been there for 2-3
Yeah.
Days.
Yeah, that's a great idea, having some kind of like timer on things so that if you don't do anything, if nothing's done, then it'll be like, hey, don't forget. Yeah, that's a great idea.
Would that kind of be like creating a future event? Like what you're saying with the maintenance sort of?
I don't know. Yeah, I think that's what we would have to figure out, is like, how would that work? Yeah, plenty of things to think about. There are also some more involved and complicated ones, like the crop planner, and I'm really interested in making a timeline slider for the map so that you can move across and see things move and change on the map over time. I think that one's like almost possible because we've got the data for it already. It's just kind of making the widget. So the only constraint really is, you know, the time, my time and the time of other contributors. So it'll happen at its own pace, but so far that's been pretty steady. So I'm optimistic.
Is the UI adaptive to devices?
Yep, it is. So it's all based on Bootstrap, which is a responsive framework, also open source. So it works. Maybe I'll live demo that if we've got some time, but it scales. So yeah, if you're on a big screen, you'll see the map over here and your plan over there. If you're on a small screen, it'll just be the map on top with your stuff below it. Yep, it should all work fine on mobile.
Categories for sales and deliveries.
So that you mean for like logging sales,
right,
and deliveries?
Like, to show that, like, after fruit's been harvested as in the box.
Yeah. So right now, the only way you can really do that is by adding an activity log to the record, which isn't, you know, it'll record that data, so you can still look back on it, but it's not super organized. So that's where the kind of like bookkeeping,
right,
and that kind of stuff is where I'm headed with it. And I've got a lot of ideas for that. Some stuff already started, but might not be in the 1.x release. Yeah.
If you have time, could you show us what the help menu, because you're not going to be there.
Sure. Well, actually, that brings me to the next slide.
Are you?
Join the community. So there's a couple of ways you can get involved, and you can find help, and you can find resources. To join the community, I always say the first thing, start using farmOS so that we can like talk about it and figure out what needs to happen. Feature requests are welcome, bug reports, etc. Most of the planning, feature and bug tracking and discussion happens in Drupal.org issue queues. You don't really need to remember that, you can get to it, or you can just like email me and I'll put it in the right place and point you to it so that you can get used to the process and that kind of thing. We also have the repositories on GitHub, which is a place that you can have open source code. Planning and general discussion is always helpful. So I host a monthly farmOS call via Google Hangouts. It's on the second Wednesday. It's on farmOS.org. FarmOS.org, go there, that'll give you all the information. That's the main point. But I think it's the second Wednesday of the month at 1 p.m. Eastern time. So anyone's allowed to join, we can talk about ideas and stuff like that. Sponsoring development would be great. Helping with documentation, farmOS.org has a bunch of documentation available, but it can always be better, it's missing some things. And contribute patches if you're a developer or not and want to start learning.
Sponsor development, is that like give a donation?
Well, so you know, most of this is done in my free time at the moment. I'm starting Farmier as a hosting service for farmOS sites. So the idea behind that is to, you know, hopefully pay for some of my time. We'll see how that goes. But yeah, another thing I've been thinking about doing, Dorn and I have talked about maybe making a nonprofit around it or pulling it in under the umbrella of another nonprofit so that we could receive support to continue development from other companies. So yeah, but sorry, just to finish that, the other option too is like if there's a specific feature that you have in mind, I mean, I'm a web developer, I work freelance and for a couple of companies and stuff. So like if a farm has like a specific thing that they really need and they want to use FarmOS, they could potentially also just hire me to create that. I'll contribute it back to the main project. So that's another option too.
And actually, related to that, do you plan on having an API?
So yeah, we already have a pretty basic REST API. It just uses the RESTful Web Services module that's available for Drupal. So that exposes all of the logs and assets so that they can be accessed by another program. Yeah, but that needs refinement. There's always more to do with that. But yeah, we've got to start on that, and that's definitely going to be a priority. Yeah. Yep. And that's also how the sensor stream works. It opens up an API that your sensor can push data to, essentially, and then it stores it. Yeah, so farmOS.org. This, you can find documentation, links to the downloads, as well as instructions for installing and setting it up if you want on your own server, all the source code you can get links to, the issue queues that I mentioned, that's where we do like feature and bug reports and stuff like that. There's frequently asked questions. I'm starting to assemble a list of farms using FarmOS. Still pretty small right now, but from the usage statistics on Drupal.org, which is public, I can see that it's more than what I have. So that's the thing with open source, you don't really, anyone can download it. I don't know who's using it, but I'd like to make a list. And then there's also some references on how to contribute and that kind of stuff. So yeah, I've got a newsletter that I send out FarmOS updates for if you're interested over there, and there's a couple of cards. But yeah, I think that's it. Do you want to look at some stuff?
Just in terms of for the crops.
Yep.
You said you make the field and then you can go through and you make your beds.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of like turning that over into, say, cover crops or the changes in the working, is that pretty easy to do? Just saying these 30 beds are now into cover crop.
Yeah. I did that myself. Let me switch over to some demo, maybe. So let's see, go to plantings. So I did a winter rye cover crop last winter, so it's no longer active. So I'm gonna filter to inactive plantings first. So in my winter rye, originally I had it covering all of my beds, and then as the season started getting underway, I kind of tilled in some or cut some and planted it into. So this is where it last ended up, but it at one point covered all these. So if I go down to all the movements, so you can see I took observations and stuff of it. These are all the movements. So originally it was planted to the whole, to this whole section. I had garlic in those ones. But yeah, you can have really fine-grained. So what you would do though is you would create your planting. You would say, create a new planting, 2016, 2017 winter rye, and then you would create a seeding log for when you're planning on seeding that or when you did seed it, and a movement log to define where it is, essentially. So one of the next things I'm going to try to do is find a clever way to merge the seedings and movements so that you don't have to do it separately. I think it's still good to have two separate logs because one is for movements and one is for the seeding, but to have them linked together somehow.
Then it automatically moves each time you, let's say, you started tilling or disking in the, you would make a new movement saying, I just those first five beds, and then it would just...
Yeah, so here's the second movement I made. So the second movement actually basically just reduced the geometry down to these beds because I tilled those ones essentially. So I have a separate activity log where I tilled those ones too, just to kind of keep it fine-grained. But it's up to you how you want to do it. That's one way, I guess. So yeah, you know, still working on trying to refine it so that it's not a ton of data entry and you're not spending all day entering things in, but that's the challenge.
This is like very impressive and exciting to think about.
Cool.
Thanks.
Yeah.
And so if you have multiple users, I understand like task assignment is coming, but mm-hmm. like in the records of activities, like does it say which user maybe entered which log?
Not at the moment. Well, it does for, so there's an egg log. And that one does have a column for that. They do store that information in the background, so all I gotta do is add the columns. Yeah. So I'll probably do that as part of the task assignment piece. Yep. So that information is already being stored, though. Yeah. If you create a log, it's assigned.
It's assigned to a person.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. Or they have a creator user. Yeah. Let's see. I'll show the. Let's see if this works. The mobile responsiveness you're asking about. So this is maybe what you would see on your phone. The menu kind of collapses into this. So you've got your So, you know, it's as good as it can get, probably. Nothing's perfect. Cool. Yeah.
Can the farms use this in their organic certification process?
Yeah. In fact, Doran has used his records with his organic certifier. In his case, they still wanted PDFs, so what he, they wanted files of some kind. So what he did is he basically just like took screenshots and turn those into things that he could use. But I think eventually I'd love to start like talking more with certifying agencies to get them to just see how this works and use this if they could.
So when he did the screenshots,
mm-hmm.
what was he doing screenshots of?
Yeah, so for him specifically, it was, you know, areas and history of assets in those areas. So that's something I can show too. Because the certifying agency wants to know, you know, what essentially what kind of inputs were in this place, what plantings were there, that kind of thing. So let me see if I've got a good example.
Is there any report generation capabilities?
No, not like nothing that will create something specific, but you know, you can, farmOS itself is a form of a report, I would say. It just depends on what your agency requires specifically. But yeah, I'm trying to make all the fields and things available so that you can create the records that they want to see, essentially. But so this is like the record for the lower garden, which is that whole bigger area. So you can see that there is what equipment is in there, what activities have taken place. Sorry, it's
okay,
mouse.
So you selected the area, and then it shows everything, cross-references, yeah, and pulls up everything
exactly
that related to that area?
Yep, exactly.
And then he just does a screen dump of that?
Yeah, yep, in whatever way that his specific agency needed. Here is the history of assets that I was talking about. So this is what they wanted to see specifically was, so this says, this lists all assets that have ever been moved to this area. So it's not just ones that are still there, it's ones that were there in the past too, throughout the season. So they wanted to be able to see what plantings he had. So, you know, you could also filter this down to just show plantings, and then it would just show the plantings. So yeah, you know, I think a simple PDF export would be a nice feature to add just to, so you don't have to screenshot. Although you can print as PDF.
Right.
Yeah, so that's the other thing, you know, because it's a browser and it's just a website, we get to leverage a lot of the things that are already available, like save as PDF.
Right, for example, website
yeah,
print to PDF.
Yeah, so you know, I'm trying to focus on these problems and let the
yeah,
other problems
so
be solved.
That's not a problem. That's
yeah,
just that's a user technique.
Yeah, right. So learning the techniques is maybe that's what we need in the documentation is some
right,
tips
is
or
tips like that.
Yeah, yep, that would be a good one. Yeah, any other questions?
So that like for that asset, so it also Google Calendar assets, like the minerals that you put in.
Yeah, so those
fertilizers or
yep, so those could be done as inputs. So let me go to show, for example, garlic. So for the inputs, I put composted horse manure in the garlic beds back in November. So that just records the input.
And inputs can also be done on fields?
Yeah.
Just individual planting?
And both at the same time, because you can see this input log is that to all four of these garlic assets and these two beds. So now, like, if I go to any one of, like, I'm on this garlic right now, so it shows up there. If I go to LGF bed one, it'll also show up there. It's the same input. So that's the cross-referencing thing, yeah.
Can you record performance on certain inputs like minerals or inoculants and say, yeah, this helped my soil or helped me increase my yield?
Yeah, so that I think is what observations would be good for. Yeah. If you want, yeah. Again, it's just ways of organizing your information right now. Eventually, I'd like to have more specific fields for that kind of thing so that you can, you know, have some actual statistics run on things.
Right, you can see, you know, the inputs that you use relative to your yields or other performance criteria.
Right.
And maybe even suppliers that,
yeah,
maybe there might be better suppliers for certain inputs.
Yeah. So
if people want to share that, then they can see, you know, community can then see,
yeah,
compare what inputs are working for what types of crops from what type of supplier.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea too, having the ability to optionally share information with others to make certain parts public if you want or the whole thing.
Business network, they do that.
Yeah, I've heard of them.
Pricing, but that's all for like big crappy, yeah,
yep,
you know, like chemical farmers out in the Midwest.
Yeah, so yep.
It's a
yep,
Google-backed venture.
Yeah,
that,
yep,
you know, has a lot of money, but they're doing a lot of good things for those types.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, so the strategy I'm kind of taking with this is creating a place to store your records and then building on top of that to get more refined statistics and more refined things. Because I think the biggest challenge for a lot of farmers right now is just the management data, just having a place to put your records and random stuff too, not like very specific numbers all the time, but like, you know, I observed something or, you know. So yeah, there's a lot to do, but that's where we're headed. I think she had it before you.
Sorry. Not to keep like suggesting things.
No,
not,
yeah, it's good.
But it just occurred to me it might be helpful to have like a star feature or something, so that like if you had an input that worked particularly well, or like like if there were five stars, we could choose like, oh, this is a five star.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I like that.
And then you could like organize all the five star things and see like the right, like so this season I really liked,
yeah,
you know, this seed or this.
That's a great idea because then it just helps you to sort of winnow down that big
right.
pool of logs that you're kind of.
It feels on. Like what the main danger would be if you can overwhelm by too much.
Yeah, yep. And again, so like the main goal is to be able to have a place to look back on stuff specifically, but you need to know what you're looking for
right.
too. Yeah,
so like,
but that would help.
If you had five stars, you really would care about the five star things and the one star things.
Yeah, right. Don't do this again next
right.
year, yeah. Or definitely do that again next year. Yeah. You had?
Yeah, do you use any, I don't know much about Ms. Drupal's workflow.
Yeah.
Use any of those?
So I don't include any of those modules yeah. with farmOS, but that is possible. And
it definitely seems like some of these are workflow problems.
Yep.
And all the dependencies of you can't do this until that happens.
Yeah.
And,
yep.
And
yeah, I think that would be a great
yeah.
a great thing to explore. Yeah. Yeah. Were you going to say something too? Or?
Yeah, but I forgot.
Okay.
I'm
yep.
bored.
It's kind of in the vein of other ideas since our island.
No.
Here,
yeah.
But
I might remember some, but email them to me later, too.
True.
Great, yeah.
Maybe having another layer of wetland and highly erodible land determination.
Ah, yeah.
Could be useful for our farms.
That's a great idea. So there is an area type for water right now, which could be used to outline wetland areas. I've seen people use it to outline streams and ponds and wells and that kind of thing. But yeah, maybe having something more specific, too, would be good, yeah. Did you? Or, yeah.
I was just wondering what, if you could see how you can do, like, getting this sort of project into, like,
yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, I do my best to try to get the word out. I have, like, newsletters and do the monthly call and stuff, but it's not really my specialty, too. More of a programmer, I guess. So yeah, I mean, just spreading the word is a huge help too. Yeah, I think we're. Oh.
Would you mind walking us through the maintenance log for tractors and implements? Because
sure.
I see that as a major advantage to this software.
Yeah.
That, for tractors, you can log hours.
Yeah.
Also, prove if you want to sell it, how much you actually.
That's a good point. Yeah, we've only got like about 30 seconds left for the end of the thing, but that's fine with me. I'll show that real quick, and then so let's look at equipment and oops. I'm not used to using this trackpad here. So I don't own a tractor, but. You have a rototiller. So with any piece of equipment, you can record activities. So you can see here, I actually recorded when I tilled the winter rye. And sometimes I have used this and forgotten to record the activities too. So you do have to stay on top of it. Observations are another type. Like I broke the pull cord on it. Maintenance, I replaced the pull cord almost. It works. Movements to different places. So you were specifically asking about like.
So are the activities in chronological order?
Yep, and you can change the sorting of it too. So you can say sort by date ascending or descending. So that's another thing I didn't really show, but all these lists have a filter and sort option. So you can. They're not totally consistent. Some have like a search and some don't. I need to go through and just be like, okay, these need to all have this. But you can also limit the dates and.
So for tractors and rototillers and things like that, for maintenance schedules, I think some of them go by the number of hours used.
Yeah.
So if you had a column, a place where you could put in hours or time
yeah.
or whatever.
So what you could do in the meantime, until like a specific field is available, you could create add an activity. So this will specifically add an activity to this tiller. I'll say tilled. And then in the notes you can say finished tilling currently at 200 hours. You can maybe read off the odometer. It's, you know, it's rough. It's not specific necessarily, but that's a great idea for a feature request, is to have some kind of tracker on the equipment. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah, actually, so another idea that came up was to have a bale counter. So if you're making hay bales, you have a counter, you click, and that just goes into your farmOS along with a GPS points of where the bales were created. So you can, I don't know why, I mean, it would be helpful in some ways. Some of it's just fun.
Well, you can see a lot.
So a lot of us need to be programmers to get all this stuff working, huh?
No, I don't think so. I think I'm trying to make it so you can use it without being a programmer. If you wanna help out and like write new features and stuff, you'd probably need some. But that's another nice thing about Drupal too, is that a lot of things can be changed directly in the interface without touching a line of code. You can actually create a module without writing any code. I won't go into all that right now because we're out of time, but maybe that's next year's talk.
That's cool. Very good.
Cool. Thanks. Thanks for coming.
Great talk.
Can I ask you a specific question?
Sure.
So I saw like on the list of assets, like you have varieties of crops and they have like a date.
Is there
a database of your assets like without those dates attached, like right, like I just use this variety of something.
Yeah,
and then are you creating a version of that?
That's a good point. So with plantings, there's actually two different things. There's plantings, which are the specific.
That's
plantings,
the thing.
And then crops and varieties, okay. Which I forgot. I should have gone over that.
Okay, so that's what I was wondering.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, so you can keep, like you can input this and then it'll just be there. So
right.
Like if I do this one
multiple
year,
multiple years,
or,
yeah.
And then I skip it,
yep.
It's still going to be there. Okay,
yep. This
cool.
Is just your whole vocabulary of crops.
Okay.
And this is sort of the basis for the crop planner that I was talking about. So each one of these you might also
be able to sort of build in the,
yeah,
like zones
the logic.
And yeah, that timeline. Yeah. No, that's
I totally forgot to show this.
I saw it up there and I was doing that.
Choose
thanks, yeah.
Which crop you have, so you everybody's using kind of like the same vocabulary.
No, this is when you get it, there's nothing in here. So that's another thing you have to enter in yourself, but you just go add a crop or variety and put in whatever you're growing that year. It's actually easier than that though, because if I go to plantings, so the difference between plantings and crops and varieties, plantings are the specific planting, like the 2016 corn. Crops and varieties is corn as a concept, sort of.
But
so,
you choose from a defined list?
No, you create your
so
you create
do
the
you
list.
Like write it in? Do you write in,
yeah,
corn? Like what if you misspell it and you spell cron?
Yeah, then you've got a messy database, yep. But one of the things that we're talking about doing is creating importable spreadsheets,
yeah,
of crops. So say you grow a lot of stuff from Johnny's or from high mowing or something, they could provide a list of crops that you could import into here.
Right, because
yeah,
the whole, I'm thinking about the whole sharing. If everybody's,
yeah,
sharing, then everybody should be using a master vocabulary.
I agree. Yeah.
Master data set,
yep,
right?
I agree. I decided not to be opinionated on that in this,
right,
because I can't predict what other,
right,
what people are going to need.
And that makes sense.
Yeah.
But after a while, you
but
can
after a
see
while,
the list, then
yeah,
you can standardize it.
Exactly.
Right.
That's what I'm hoping. And so then what you would have is you might have a feature that lets you merge together two different terms. So if you misspelled something, you can merge it into corn,
right,
so that
right,
it's all corn.
Like Google tells you, did you really mean,
yeah,
that? You know, you sure you,
yeah,
didn't mean this?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Could it suggest, or could it have like a whole master list, but then sort it by like most used or something.
Yeah, so
that's a good idea.
Right now we kind of have that. This shows like how many are currently planted,
mm-hmm,
of that, how many plantings are currently out,
right,
there, but it doesn't show past,
right,
ones. So that would be a good idea. Yeah.
I have one more good idea for you.
Okay.
For sponsorship.
Yeah.
Ask people like Google, because they like to, they have that kind of an attitude. They'd like to support,
yeah,
the organic movement and just be right up there.
They're very supporting of open source too, a lot, yeah, of the stuff that they do.
Yeah.
If you don't ask, they won't give you anything.
That's true, yeah, gotta ask. Thanks for coming.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, sure. Yeah,
well,
download
you'll
it.
You'll be hearing from me.
Okay, great. What was your name?
John Martin.
John Martin, I'm Mike. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Cool.
Have you been contacted by anyone in China or Taiwan? Yeah. Is there a Chinese language version of this?
So yeah, there was actually someone contacted me on Twitter and said, thanks for the software, we're going to try to use it in China.
Mm.
Yeah, it was a, the translation stuff is going to be better in the 2.x.
Yeah.
Right now, the 1.x is built on Drupal 7, mm-hmm. which has translation modules available that you can plug in, so
yeah.
people out there can do it and start contributing translations. Drupal 8, which is what the 2.x is going to be built on, has the translations and localization
yeah.
stuff baked right into core. So
oh, interesting.
So that'll just, we'll just get that. So not necessarily translations automatically,
right.
but the management of those translations. So
okay.
people will be able to just enable a module and translate live on their thing and contribute that back to the project so that
okay.
someone else can just be like, I'm using this language, and they'll get those translations.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Because yeah. I did research about sustainable agriculture in China last
oh, cool.
year. And
okay.
It's funny you didn't mention, this is just a side note, but in China there's a huge issue with transparency. People and consumers desperately want transparency because they don't trust that people are actually growing organic when they say fraud
yeah.
fears.
Yeah.
And so I know a lot of farms that would love to be able to, and there are a lot of apps, but you pay for them in China.
Okay.
For
yeah.
that, like, you know, all the customers can go and look at what field by field what
yep.
farms have been doing, but this would be a really interesting way
yeah,
to
that's
kind
a great
of
idea.
Like make that accessible. Cool. Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure, no problem. I should probably start packing up in case there's someone else coming in after me.
Yeah.